choices, anyway. Why have about 12, about 11 to 10, 25, is that the right time?
Thank you. Good morning. In the name of Jesus Christ, welcome. The regathering has begun. This is the first day of Sunday school. There's an opportunity to register for Sunday school, and there will also be classes today. And this opportunity will continue, of course, through the month of September and into October. Regathering tends to take several weeks. This is the first Sunday of the season of creation. It's a five-Sunday period intended to allow us to reflect on our place within creation, the wonder of creation, and our responsibilities within that. I want to welcome those who are visiting this morning, at least those whom I've been able to identify. We have Joy and Basil Ikede's son, Dr. Ajiri Ikede, and also Avery, who is Ajiri's son and Basil and Joy's grandson. We have Bruce Wanacott, who is visiting from Toronto, I think it is. And we also have Vernon and Isabel Clark, who are visiting with us this morning. There may be others, and if so, you are most welcome. Following the service, there will be a time of conversation and some refreshments in the church gym to which everyone is invited. And of course, I want to welcome our guest soloist, Michael Vandergag, and those who are joining us via Eastlink Television this morning. We have a sympathy announcement to Charles and Alma Much and their family on the death of their son, David Much. David was a young man who leaves behind a young family. So the Muches need your prayers and support. Today is Claude and Bernice Bell's 63rd wedding anniversary, so congratulations to them. And Claude is at the moment in the hospital. Now, we did have a notice of Rick Forsythe's birthday a little earlier in the month, but he's back today. And I think this is a picture from the Newfoundland vacation, is it? Is that where it's from? So happy birthday to Rick, who celebrated his birthday on September the 5th. And Justin Thompson, who is the redhead in that picture, will be 12 years old on September the 17th. And Erin Fraser will be 11 years old on September the 19th. She's the one with the hair. So the Community in Bloom contest has been held. The judging has been done. And Trinity United Church received first prize in the Adopt a Corner category. That's for the corner across the street. And I want to thank Kathy Burt for representing the congregation and picking up the award. Just some announcements about meetings. The UCW general meeting will be held tomorrow at 10 a.m. Outreach committee meets Monday at 7 p.m. Worship committee meets Tuesday at 7 p.m. And the pastoral care committee meets on Wednesday at 5:30 p.m. So if you are involved in any of those, please take note. There will also be a meeting on Thursday night here at Trinity for those interested in Syrian refugee sponsorship. And that will be at 7 o'clock. And we're hoping that other United Churches in the area will be interested. I know there's also some interest from St. Paul's across the street. So we may be able to get together a community effort. Next Sunday, there will be a welcome back corn boil after church. The menu will feature corn, hot dogs, and make your own sundae. I'm sure Greg Davis will be looking for some volunteers to help him with that, so just don't mob him and trample him after church, lining up to help. Note about the gala dinner, on September the 26th. I think there are a few tickets available. This is because of some dislocation with people having unavoidable changes of plans and some people becoming ill. So you can check with the church office through the week if you're interested in getting a ticket to the gala dinner. And now, Logan Duckworth and Colton Duckworth have an announcement to make.
Hi, guys. The sermon committee is really looking for youth input on what they think they can do to get the youth more involved in the church and what they would like to see more of youth liking in the church. So we're going to have a meeting on September 25th at Martha Deacon's place, if Martha can raise her hand. Right over there. at 69 Upper Prince Street with a barbecue, music, whole nine yards. We will have a special guest, Reverend Keith Gale, in attendance as well. We will really appreciate if as many youth as possible could attend this event and give their suggestions on what they think they could do to get youth more involved in the church and what they think they could do to make it more appealing to everyone. If you're interested, please meet me and Colton over in that corner of the church at the end of service today. Thanks.
See, Colton hasn't lost his form. He managed to get Logan to do all the talking. Let us build a house where love can dwell.
There was a person who said such wonderful things and did such marvelous things that people began to follow him. One day they asked, "Who are you?" He answered them, "I am the light."
You may be seated.
We sing of Jesus, a Jew, born to a woman in poverty, in a time of social upheaval and political oppression. He knew human joy and sorrow. So filled with the Holy Spirit was he, that in him people experienced the presence of God among them. We sing praise to God incarnate. Jesus announced the coming of God's reign, a commonwealth not of domination, but of peace, justice, and reconciliation. He healed the sick and fed the hungry. He forgave sins and freed those held captive by all manner of demonic powers. He crossed barriers of race, class, culture, gender. He preached and practiced unconditional love. Love of God, of neighbor, love of friend, love of enemy. And he commanded his followers to love one another as he had loved them. Because his witness to love was threatening, those exercising power sought to silence Jesus. He suffered abandonment and betrayal, state-sanctioned torture and execution. He was crucified. But death was not the last word. God raised Jesus from death, turning sorrow into joy, despair into hope. We sing of Jesus, raised from the dead.
We sing, hallelujah. Hymn number 326, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. Now Dan will lead us in prayer.
Because of your grace and beauty, your compassion and truth, we offer you our tongues, O God, as instruments of praise. In joy and celebration, in grief and despair, may we praise you for your constant presence with those we love and with those whom we find it difficult to love. May peace
praise you through words of grace and respect.
When the world feels safe and right, and when the world is made threatening through propaganda, hate speech, and rhetoric of violence, may we praise you through words of truth,
of peace, and justice.
And so in all things, with all people, at all times, may our tongues speak only praise for the sake of your reign
and your glory,
through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
We'll remain seated as we sing the first two verses of hymn 345. And as we sing, I'll ask the children to join Greg at the front, please.
Well, good morning, everyone. Now, some of you are looking away from me. I want to see your nice, smiley faces. There we go. Yeah. It's really good to see you. And my gosh, where have you been hiding? Homes, that's right. Did you have a good summer? Did you have lots of fun? Did you? Did you do special things? Yeah. So it was a pretty cool summer. So who started school? Anybody start school? You did? Oh, cool. Yeah. How was school? Was it good? Was it exciting?
Yeah.
Did you meet new friends?
Yeah.
What was one thing that was very special when you went into the school? Can someone share one special thing that when they went to school? And what was in grade one class?
We didn't get to do a lot of things.
You didn't get to do a lot of things?
No.
Yes. So you probably had to meet some new friends? Not new friends, but met a lot of friends that you knew from last year. That's cool. So you went to school. You had a great time at school, and then where did you go after maybe the bus picked you up or maybe someone picked you up at school? Where did you go then? Home. And were you saying, oh, I don't want to be home? Or did you say, whoa, it's nice to be home again? Did you say that? And why was it nice to be back home again? Because you could tell your families about the school day. How did you feel when you went home? Did you feel sort of sad? Did you feel happy?
Yeah.
You did. Did you feel like, welcome home, it's really good to see you?
Yeah.
You did that? Did you feel love? That you were going home and people loved you, and they were very interested in what you were doing at school and how your day went. Did you feel that? Those are all pretty cool feelings. And you know, I suspect that people who knew Jesus, there's lots of stories in the Bible about Jesus, and a lot of the stories tell us about how Jesus welcomed people to be around him and really was interested in how they were doing. Now, I'd like to think that when we come back to church and when we start Sunday school, it's like going to that very special place where we feel really, really welcomed, that we feel really, really good to be here. Because you know what? Each of you are very special. Now, John had mentioned earlier that this the season that we're in is creation season, and you'll learn about that in Sunday school, especially in godly play, the creation. And you know what? We believe that God created each and every beautiful person. And you know what? Each of you, all of us, are very beautiful, special people. And it's really good to see you. So when we go to school today, we'll celebrate and we're going to learn new things, and it's going to be a lot of fun. So it's really good to have you back, and it's really good to rub shoulders with you again and do some chatting too. Okay? Let's have a prayer together, and you can repeat after me, okay? Hi, God.
Hi, God.
Thank you for this wonderful day.
Thank you for this wonderful day.
And the many creations around us. That you have made our friends. Thank you, God, for being our God. I'll talk to you later, God. Amen. I'm going to invite you to stand up. And we always say that special prayer of Jesus, the Our Father. And let's share that with the congregation. And then the big boys and girls can join in as we share that prayer. So let's lead the congregation in this prayer. Are we ready? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Okay, we're going to be going out through here to Sunday school. And if you're new, you can just follow me along, okay?
Responsive psalm this morning is Psalm 19, and please join with the choir to sing the refrain. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the vault of the sky reveals God's handiwork. And this without speech or language, their voices are not heard.
But their sound goes out to all the lands, their words to the ends of the earth.
Glory and praise to God, whose word brings life.
In the heavens, God has pitched a tent for the sun. which comes out like a bridegroom from under the canopy, like an athlete eager to run the race.
Its rising is at one end of the sky. It runs its course to the other, and there is nothing that is hidden from its heat.
God's law is perfect, refreshing the soul.
God's instruction is sure, giving wisdom to the simple.
God's precepts are right, rejoicing the heart.
God's commandment is pure, giving light to the eyes.
God's fear is clean, enduring forever.
God's judgments are true, every one of them is righteous.
More desirable than gold, even much fine gold.
Sweeter also than honey, pure honey from the comb.
Glory and praise to God, whose word brings life.
By them is your servant warned.
For in keeping them there is great reward.
But who can discern unwitting sins?
Oh, cleanse me from my secret faults.
And keep your servant also from presumptuous sins, lest they get the better of me.
Then shall I be clean and innocent of a great offense.
Glory and praise to God, whose word brings life.
Let us say together, let the words of my mouth and the thoughts of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O God, my strength and my Redeemer. Amen. The Gospel according to St. Mark, chapter 8, verses 27 to 38. Jesus set out with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi. On the way, he asked them, "Who do people say that I am?" They answered, "Some say John the Baptist. others Elijah, others still one of the prophets. "But who do you say that I am?" he asked. Peter answered, "You are the Messiah." Then Jesus sternly ordered them not to tell anyone about him. And he began to tell his disciples how the Son of Man must be betrayed and undergo great suffering, must be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and 3 days later rise again. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But Jesus turned to his disciples and rebuked Peter. "Get behind me, Satan," he said. "You are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." And then, calling the crowd together with his disciples, he said to them, "If any want to become followers of mine, let them deny themselves and take up the cross and follow me." Those who would save their lives will lose them. But whoever loses life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will live. Indeed, what does it profit anyone to gain the whole world and lose life, lose their very being? What matters most? And he said, "Anyone who is ashamed of me in this wicked and adulterous generation, of that person will the Son of Man be ashamed when the Son of Man comes in the glory of the Father." This is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us pray. And if you weren't aware, you know this morning the origin of the pre-sermon prayer that I always use. "Now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen." 2 weeks from today, on September the 27th, if the skies are clear, we will see an eclipse of the moon. And not just your average lunar eclipse. The moon in the sky that night will be a supermoon. A supermoon is possible because the Earth's orbit around the Earth is not a perfect circle. It is an ellipse. And so at its farthest point from the Earth, at the apogee of its orbit, the moon is 384,600 kilometers away from us. Well, no, I'm sorry. This is the average distance. This is the average distance, 384,600 kilometers. At the apogee, the farthest point, the distance is 405,600 kilometers. And at the perigee, the nearest point, the moon is a mere 363,700 kilometers away. A super moon occurs when the moon is at the perigee or at the nearest point of its orbit. And at that point, it's 14% larger in appearance and 30% brighter than when it's at the farthest point away from us. So it should be a pretty impressive sight to see the moon and then to see the eclipse. I wonder how long it's been that human beings have been gazing up at the night sky and wondering what creative force and put all of that in place? How long have human beings been looking up and being filled with awe and filled with a sense that we are not the most important things in the universe, and that there is a whole lot that is beyond our understanding that transcends our rather puny reality? It's not only the night sky that causes this sense of wonder. 5,000 years ago, people in southern England on the Salisbury Plain observed that the summer solstice struck the land at a certain angle, at a certain time, every year. And so they built this ancient temple in order to focus the sun's rays, in order to be in tune with the sun's course through the heavens. There's a whole lot about Stonehenge that we don't understand, but most scholars are in agreement that it has to do with the summer solstice. Before Stonehenge, there was an even older temple that was probably based on the worship of points in the landscape, things like hills, mountains, and rivers. About the same time that Stonehenge was being built, the Egyptians observed that Sirius, the dog star, is in line with the rising sun in the morning sky at the time of year when the Nile begins to flood. Of course, the Nile is the source of life still today in Egypt. And so they developed a calendar beginning with the alignment of Sirius and the sun. And there were times when certain of the pharaohs tried to overthrow the ancient religion and adopt a worship based on the worship of the sun. It may be that that was the first form of monotheism that the world had ever known. That is, the worship of one God only. Now, I'm reminded of an elderly Scotsman who, during an evening service, heard the minister waxing on about the wonders of the heavens and how small we are in comparison. And afterwards, he went outside, and as the minister greeted him, he looked up at the night sky and said, "I refuse to be astronomically intimidated." But many people are astronomically intimidated. A sense of wonder, the sense that the 19th Psalm has about the silent witness of the heavens, about the eloquent speech that speaks without speaking, it is not always appreciated. People don't always come to that conclusion. And Ursula Goodenow, a cell biologist, writes in her book, The Sacred Depths of Creation, of a camping experience under the stars. She says, "I found myself in a sleeping bag, looking up into the crisp Colorado night. Before I could look around for Orion or for the Big Dipper, I was overwhelmed with terror. The panic became so acute that I had to roll over and bury my face in my pillow. When I later encountered the famous quote from physicist Steven Weinberg, the more the universe seems comprehensible, the more it seems pointless, I wallowed in its poignant nihilism. A bleak emptiness overtook me whenever I thought about what was really going on out in the cosmos or deep in the atom. The more the universe seems comprehensible, the more it seems pointless." Now, Albert Einstein, who was probably the greatest mind of the 20th century, was not a religious believer in any conventional sense. That is to say, he didn't belong to a church, or a synagogue. He didn't pray. He didn't believe in a God who would answer prayer. He said, however, in contrast to what we've just heard, that the comprehensibility of the universe, our ability to understand the universe, is its greatest mystery. And Einstein found a sense of transcendence in the quest of the human mind to know and to understand. He said that his faith was in the orderly unfolding of the universe, not in a God who cares about human beings, either collectively or individually. About a year before his death, he wrote, "I am a deeply religious unbeliever." A deeply religious unbeliever, one who had a sense of awe, one who had a sense of transcendent reality, but who could not bring himself to believe in a God who actually cares about people like us. And that is hard to believe. It's a tremendous claim that if there is a power which brought all this magnificence into being, that that power cares about us on this insignificant planet, in an insignificant solar system, in an insignificant galaxy, in a vast and sprawling universe. The eighth psalm asks or says, "Oh, when I look at the stars, the work of your fingers, what are mortals that you mind them, or human beings that you care for them?" What indeed? And yet, through the centuries, people have not only been awed by creation, they have sought some assurance that there is that within or outside of creation which does indeed take note of us. That, in fact, is the majority opinion. We live in a time when certain strident atheists have gone much further than Albert Einstein would ever have gone in denouncing faith. Their creed is Weinberg's creed. The more the universe is understandable, the more pointless it seems. I recall some words of Wilfred Cantwell Smith, who was a scholar of comparative religion at Harvard University. And this is what he wrote. "After all, the overwhelming majority of intelligent persons, at most times and places, and all cultures other than in part of the recent West, have recognized the transcendent quality of man and the world. To be a secularist in the negative sense is oddly parochial in both space and time, and to opt for what may be a dying culture. It is important that we keep in conversation with this group, but important also that we do not fall victim to, nor treat with anything but compassion, its incapacity to see." Now, translated, what Smith is saying is that most times and places, people have believed in the transcendent reality of a divine being, divine beings who care about us, who have some concern for our welfare. And this bleak atheism is a minority position. Now, we can say, of course, that all those who have gone before us were delusional, and we at last are smart enough to get it right. Or we might exercise a bit of humility in the face of all that history and ask ourselves, what was it that led them to these beliefs, to these conclusions? What was it that inspired them with the sense that we are indeed not alone, not abandoned to the indifference of the creation around us? Now, Psalm 19 holds two things together. First of all, there is the witness of the heavens, and the speech of the moon and the stars and the sun. And then there is the witness of Torah, the witness of the law. And what we have in the second part of that psalm is a sort of ode to the law, a hymn in praise of the law, how it is, how it revives the soul, how it makes the simple wise, how it is sweeter even than the drippings of the honeycomb, how it is precious, more to be valued than much fine gold. It was the conviction of the tradition of Israel that in order to truly know God, we couldn't simply kneel before the wonder of creation. We had to have God's word to us, God's revelation. We had to have guidance as to how to enter into relationship with God and to walk with God through this world. And that's what Torah, that's what the law was about. Of course, as Christians, conditioned by centuries of anti-Jewish polemic, we tend to say, well, the law was stifling, the law was a straitjacket, the law dried up people's souls. That was not the experience of most Jews. It was a way in which God was alive for them, in which the very reality of God shaped their lives. So what of us who are Christians? Some would say, well, it's not just the law, it's the whole Bible. So we have creation, and then we have the Bible, and the Bible answers every question that we may have. And tells us all we need to know about creation, about God, about everything else. That, my friends, is not the heart of the Christian faith. The heart of the Christian faith is much more scandalous, much more startling than reverence for or worship of a book. Now, at the heart of this faith, there is Jesus Christ. And Christian faith makes some rather large claims for this humble Galilean. In their most exalted and most presumptuous, these claims say that he was very God of very God, begotten, not created. He was there with God before all worlds, before all dreams. And to know Jesus is to know God. That indeed is a breathtaking claim if we really pause to let its magnificence flow over us. And we have wanted somehow to square this confession with the way the world is. We have wanted to forget who Jesus really was. And so we've dressed him up in all of these imperial trappings. But at the heart of everything, before anything else can be said about him, Jesus is the one who carries the cross. And he is the one who invites us to join him in his cross bearing. Now, what does it mean to carry the cross? You've probably seen paintings of the procession to Golgotha. It usually shows Jesus bearing this heavy burden and sometimes falling under it. And the way is lined with people who are taunting and jeering, and people who are saying things like, "You saved others, why don't you save yourself? If you are the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One, then why don't you come down from the cross?" This was all part of the ritual in the ancient world. in the Roman Empire. When victims were taken out to the cross, onlookers were encouraged. They were expected to take part in the taunting. They were expected to add their voices to the pain and the humiliation. And often they added their spit and the handfuls of excrement, the rocks that they could grab from the roadway, and they would cast those at the ones who were about to be crucified. It meant that if you were doing that, you were identified with the imperial power, not with the helpless victim. You were saying, I'm with you, Caesar. I'm on your side. And what we have to do is get rid of this miserable malcontent, this criminal, this person who is no longer worthy to live among us. And so you didn't carry the cross. You joined in vilifying the victims of the cross. But Jesus says, if you want to find your life, if you want to find what's truly important, then you're going to have to join me in carrying the cross. You're going to have to be identified as I was with the outsiders, with the outcasts, with the powerless and the voiceless. That's the message here. It's not a message about stoically bearing any problems that come to us, although sometimes that's a helpful way to proceed. It's not a message about trusting Jesus simply to redeem us from our sins on the cross, although I pray God that that happens as well. But first and foremost, what this says is that if you want to know where God is in the world, if you want to know about the God who cares for us, the God who longs to be with us, then look at those who are carrying the crosses. Look at those who are being taunted and humiliated, those who are being cast out, and there you will find God. As I said earlier, we don't want to hear that, because we always want to be on Caesar's side, or at least on the side of the person who represents power and place and privilege. And that's why Christians built so many churches over the centuries, so many magnificent buildings and cathedrals. They were a sign that we're not among the voiceless anymore. We are part of the in-group now. Indeed, we have the power to oppress as once we were oppressed. And think of the beginnings of Methodism here on Prince Edward Island. Humble origins. A few people gathered in Benjamin Chapel's house to pray. And then progressively, they built ever larger and more splendid churches. Until today, we have this church in which we're gathered this morning. And there were all kinds of motives for that. There was deep faith, but always there was a sense that now we have arrived. We're not in the procession with that lonely Galilean anymore. We have joined the crowd. Now, Jesus calls us to identify God in all those places of hurt, exclusion that we encounter. And he calls us to follow him there. We could think of many ways in which we can do this, and many possibilities and challenges which this opens up for us. I think right now, one of the great challenges is what we're going to do in response to the humanitarian crisis of the Syrian refugees. The people who are in power say you have to be careful because they may be a threat to us. And yes, I suspect that that is a possibility if we're honest about it, that in all those hundreds of thousands, millions of people, there may be some rotten eggs and people who would not be good citizens. But consider the threat to our humanity, the threat to our discipleship if we do nothing. If we see these people cast up on foreign shores, and these people fleeing for their lives, and simply say, well, we can't take the risk. That's no concern of ours. That is an assault on our humanity as well as theirs. And it's also a denial of what we know about where God is to be found in this world, about how we honor God and about how we follow Christ. I expect you are all deeply inspired by the sexy title of the sermon, Psalm 19 and Jesus. But I think you begin to see what I mean. There is the witness of this beautiful creation that fills us with awe. But there is the immediacy of God's presence, and there is always that invitation to walk with God, to have our lives shaped by the reality of God, and to carry the cross as Jesus carried the cross. And in giving up ourselves and letting go of our fears and our grasping, to find who we truly are. Who do you say that I am? Jesus asked the disciples. We all have to answer that question sooner or later. But in answering that question, we also make a statement about who we are. And may we be found among Jesus' friends, among Jesus' disciples. Thanks be to God. Amen. Hymn number 567, Will You Come and Follow Me?
You.
Let us pray. God, we thank you for the marvels of creation. We thank you for the vast universe. We thank you for its mystery and its power. And we thank you that you have given us minds to search that mystery, that always on the wings of thought and dream, we are questing to know more, and to understand more fully. And we thank you for all the ways in which the witness of creation speaks to us. And we thank you for the witness of faith, and for the witness of Torah, which called Israel to walk with you in the way of the wise, in the way of justice, in the way of truth. We thank you for Jesus Christ, who comes to us, in whom our faith says we know as much as we're ever going to know about you. We thank you for his witness and for his example. We thank you for his cross-bearing on all our behalf, on behalf of all humankind, his lifting of our burden of selfishness and guilt, and his invitation to let ourselves go and to open ourselves to the fullness and the joy of life, even the suffering and complexity of life. We remember before you all the people who this day carry crosses, and people who carry grief, and people who carry guilt, and people who carry hatred, and people who carry fear, and people who carry suspicion and prejudice, all people who need to be set free. We remember those who are most vulnerable to violence, and to hatred, and to selfishness. And we remember Jesus' call for us to be with them. God, it is easy for us to join with those who shout, "Crucify, crucify." It is easy for us to be with the onlookers who want no part of this cross-bearing, who want to be in Caesar's good graces. But we know where you are, and if we want to live truly, there we will be also. Give us grace, give us patience, give us courage, give us wisdom, that this may be so. In Jesus' name, amen. And now we continue to worship God with the presentation of offerings which sustain the work of this church here and in all the world. Your offerings will be received.
Oh!
Let us pray. For some of us, these gifts are a sacrificial offering, a denial of self to follow Christ. For others, they are a little bit off the top, an afterthought for something not very important. In mercy, O God, receive all our giving, and bless it in the service of your righteous kingdom, for the sake of Jesus, the cross-bearer. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 356. He came singing love. As we go from here, may we find God in the wonder of the world around us, in the night sky as the supermoon rises, in the gentle breeze and in the howling gale, in the voice of the thunder and in the voice of the singing bird. But may we know that the presence of God is given to us in Jesus the Galilean, who carries the cross. And may we follow him. Now may grace, mercy, and peace, and the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Ask you to be seated for a moment for a brief announcement. What I have to say is rather difficult, but I have to say it. Earlier this year, I indicated to you that I would be leaving on 30th of June in 2016, and that set in motion a process of discernment to reflect on the future of the congregation and to hold conversations with various people and groups in the conversation or the congregation. And that process is nearing its completion now. But when I said I would be leaving next June, I deliberately didn't say that I would be retiring, because I hoped that there would be an opportunity to continue ministry elsewhere. And such an opportunity has presented itself I'm not at liberty to disclose the location because, of course, there are still lots of loose ends to be tied up. And I'm taking something of a risk in making this announcement in view of all of those loose ends. But I want to give you as much notice as possible. The standard requirement for notice is 90 days. And you give 90 days notice, and there's no problem with that. If I were to give 90 days notice now, it would mean moving sometime during the holiday season, probably sometime over the new year, which I think you'll agree is a very bad time of year to be moving. Perhaps I could ask that we delay until sometime in the new year, but I'm not sure that the opportunity would necessarily be there. And so I'm having to throw myself on the mercy of the pastoral charge and of the presbytery to ask for an early release. And the time framing, the time frame that I'm proposing is that my last Sunday with you would be the 15th of November. So that's less than 90 days, but if the church council agrees to it, then the presbytery will probably consent as well. As I say, there are a lot of loose ends here, and I could end up with egg all over my face, but I thought, in fairness, I'd give you as much notice as I possibly could. And I know we were looking at another few months together, and that seemed to be the way it was going to be, but there is this opportunity to continue the ministry in a different context where I think I'll be able to be helpful and to make a difference. So I'm asking for your understanding on that count. And I've always said, you know, that cemeteries everywhere are full of indispensable people. So there's no particular minister, no one person who is the key to everything. And that's certainly the case here. This ministry is the work of all the people. And I wish you God's blessing and grace as you continue that work and witness. Thank you. To talk to you about that would be Earl Watercock, astronomer. Yes. Thank you. Roger. Thank you.